Jack, do you think it's fair to say that the guys are maybe lacking a bit of confidence at the moment? I mean, there were just moments that maybe betrayed that, you know, kicking a few balls away on attack,
yeah.
A few flustered kicks. And I just think of that time just before the storm, a second try when Ruin stepped over and could have actually grabbed the ball. The ref had said, you know, it's out in the open, but
yes.
he didn't. And it,
yeah, okay. No, I mean, look, I don't know if it's, I mean, we had our chances. I mean, I think firstly, I must say, I want to just thank all the supporters for coming out. I think it was a great advert for South African rugby that we get 41,000 people to a derby game. So, and, you know, I suppose if people ask me what I feel a little bit disappointed because we probably didn't play as well as we would like in front of that crowd. And in a lot of ways, we probably made the same mistakes we made in Cape Town in Christmas. You know, we were 12-3 up. We looked like we had control and sort of, I don't know, maybe in about sort of 10, 15 minutes of, and it wasn't in 10, 15 minutes, but in 10, 15 minutes of decision-making, we probably made a couple of mistakes, which cost us, you know. We got a turnover, kicked the ball, got charged down. Yeah, I mean, had a chance with Cornell there when, you know, literally touch and go about getting his jersey out of the contact and scoring. But those are the margins, and I think, you know, I've got to give credit to the Stormers. They too played in front of a big crowd. They too had to come back from 12-3 down, and they look like a team that's obviously, you know, it's obviously experienced and coping with that kind of pressure. You know, I mean, Marnie Libok kicking that drop kick is basically the difference. Yeah, and I mean, so you got to give them credit and say, after all that, we still had a chance. I mean, that's the amazing thing. 2 5-meter, you know, lineouts. So we should have finished one of those to finish the game off.
Frustrated with where the scrums went.
Yeah, look, I think a lot of things that are, you know, obviously, I've got to be careful because I don't want to be getting into referees again. But there were a couple of decisions that I thought, you know, the one turnover they got under the poles, it looked like one of their guys was stuck in the wrong side. And generally, sometimes you get the rub of the green there. I thought in the beginning of the game there was a little bit of gamesmanship in the scrum, and we probably didn't get the rub of the green there as well. But yeah, I mean, that's what happens, guys. I mean, I've been doing this a long time. Sometimes when you're riding the crest of the wave and you're a good side, you seem to get those calls, you know. And sometimes when you've got your backs against the wall and you sort of need a call like that to go for you, you don't get them. So yeah, so, I mean, we just got to, as I said to the players, we could play the Stormers again. You know, we could end up fifth and they could end up fourth. We could end up sixth and they could end up third. You know, we could end up seventh and they could end up second. So we end up playing them again, you know. So it's one of those things. I mean, I think we've got to look at the situation of that game. We had our chances. I mean, to be fair, as I said, Cornell held up there, you know, basically yard from the try line, 2 5-meter lineouts. The pressure we were building under their poles there. Didn't finish it off again, you know. At the first half, I think we had 65% possession and maybe 56% territory. And we're down 13-12. You know, you ask yourself, how does that happen, you know? So I suppose it's something we're going to have to really think about in terms of how we put teams away when we've got 65% possession and 56% territory. Because we started really well. I mean, I just thought we could have maybe got rewarded once or twice when we held the ball for 10, 15 phases and no one rolled away, that we sort of didn't get any reward there for holding on to it, you know.
Jake, welcome back. Good to see you in good health once again.
Thank you.
Mornie Steyn comes in the game, hits a 50-22. The momentum nearly changes right there.
Yes.
You feel it in the crowd. You had some phases built up, then kind of lost the ball. But
yes.
It looked like the game was going to swing at that moment.
It did. I mean, I thought actually had visions of Mornie Steyn coming on. I thought we'd even score and he'd convert the conversion and then basically, you know, just show that he's what he's worth to our club. And that would have been nice way to send it off. But, you know, it wasn't meant to be. And you're right, that 50-22, I mean, it's basically from a catch in his own 22, kicks it the whole length of the field. So it's nice to have that caliber of player in your squad. Yeah, it was just a difficult one. When I look back, you know, we lost Nizam with a hamstring injury after Carl got a bit of a bang. So all of a sudden, we're playing with a lock at loose forward. And, you know, maybe in hindsight, and I know it's always easy, maybe we should have thrown to the lock at the back of the line-out at the end there, because I would never have expected that, you know. But if we had and then we had lost the line out, we would have said, geez, why didn't we throw to the best jumper in the competition? So, yeah, I mean, credit to them. They didn't have to go up in that line out, and they went up and they won it. You know, so if they'd stayed down, who knows, maybe we would have, you know, been able to maul over the try line. So, yeah, it's one of those games, guys. I think, you know, you look at the coach and you want to hear what he's going to say. It's not a great feeling to let one of those slip away, because I think we could have, in front of our supporters, we could have maybe pulled that one over the line.
Coach, just your reflection on Boo back in the summer.
Yeah, geez, I just said to him, I'm very proud of him, you know. We take it for granted that a young boy who's been going through a difficult time, I thought he played quite well. You know, I thought his work rate was good, he ran hard, he didn't look like he's been out of rugby for 3 months, you know. So, yeah, I mean, I'm really proud that he could play like that. I'm sure he'll get better. I'm sure now that he's got the taste of it again. You know, I mean, he basically broke every tackle when he carried. He looked like a Springbok again, which is always nice when you've got that kind of play in your squad.
Jake, just obviously it makes the road ahead quite difficult now. You've got some big games, Ulster and Leinster still ahead. All these problems, can you fix them before them? Or?
Yeah, look, I mean, hey, that's why we're in coaching and that's why we're in rugby. You know, sometimes, Brendan, you know, last year you get the high road or the low road. You know, now we're obviously on the dirt road. You know, so this is the test we have. You know, it's a test for everybody. So we're not dead. We're not dead yet. I mean, obviously we would have been much more alive if we had won this game, but we're not dead. I mean, the point is we still got hope in the competition. We just got a very tough draw now, you know, because basically the destiny is now on other guys winning and losing. And if we come fifth, we're going to end up, you know, maybe it's, we play the guys who come fourth, you know. Sometimes you come fourth and you win that game, you've got to play Leinster away, you know. And we know how tough that is. So it's not going to get any easier for anybody, you know.
Just on that first try of the Storm, was that bad defensive
read? Yeah, well, I don't know about that. I mean, one of the things, again, I'm only going to give you what I heard before the game. I heard that they're not going to allow players to break the 5-metre line like they did in the final from a scrum. That's what I heard.
Basically, all the stats were in your favour.
Yes.
That must be frustrating as a coach.
Very.
How do you break that barrier?
Yeah. You know, Chris, I'm going to tell you that, I mean, I'm going to sit and tell you after experience and years of experience, sometimes it is like that in sport, you know. And it's not nice. I mean, it's not nice when you come in the change room and you've played reasonably well and you've dominated certain things and you just don't get over the line, you know. So, you know, conversely, sometimes you get away with it. Sometimes you don't play your best rugby thing, ball bounces for you, you know, things work in your favour. You know, I mean, as I said to you, I mean, I don't want to have a whole rundown of the game, but they knock the ball on, you know, we get it, we kick it, they charge it down, they carry on playing. Now, some ref would blow in and say it's a knock-on first, no advantage, bull scrum. That's the margin, you know. He plays on, Sanatla gets through again, and all of a sudden we're under the pump, you know. And that's why. Sometimes it goes for you, sometimes it doesn't. So to answer your question, it is frustrating. I mean, it's frustrating because you really want everything to be perfect. But, you know, we're gonna have to find solutions to how we handle pressure, you know. That's the thing. And the only way you learn that is if you put people under pressure. You know, you can't simulate it at training, you can't say to players, this is what it feels like, whatever, until he's actually in that situation. 41,000 people, 5-metre line out, you've got to throw it in, you lose the line out, you know. I mean, I've seen Bismarck do it. I've seen Malcolm Marks do it. Some of the best players in the world have done it. So, you know, that's what you've got to get used to. So, yeah, well, I'll get it right. I mean, I'm 100% sure I'll get it right. You know, I've seen this before. And I'm 100% sure that we got the... No one wasn't trying tonight. No one wasn't. I mean, at the end of the game there, it was still... The Bulls could still win it. And that says a lot for where we were, you know, considering that a lot of people would have thought we were going to lose that game when we were down, you know.
Jake, you mentioned those opportunities from the 5-metre line-out.
Yes.
But it seems like this season you don't seem to be getting much joy from holding mauls. And last season you seemed to be the cornerstone of your road to the final.
Not quite. We didn't score too many maul tries last year either. I think, to be fair, what's happening is I think generally rugby, people aren't scoring maul tries. You know, if you look at... The interesting thing is the top 14, the French sides are scoring, but generally the European, I mean the English clubs and the URC teams aren't scoring more tries. So, which is a, It's an interesting stat, you know, and I'm not saying because it's us. It's generally across the board. Teams aren't scoring. Even the Stormers tonight, guys, didn't score a maul try, and that's generally one of their kingpin things. I know they lost the ball over the try line, but you know, it's. I think generally what's happening is it's much tougher now for whatever reason. I think teams are not for us. Teams are generally stopping the maul much better.
I know there was something said this week about Seldon not being
here. Yes.
And Rowan being a young captain. Or
something. Yes.
But do you feel? Not so much on Ruan, but do you feel that your pack is maybe missing the Marcel type player?
Yeah, listen, we're missing. I mean, of course, you know, I mean, everyone wants to load their pack with abrasive guys like Marcel. You know, I mean, you see teams when they lose one or two guys, the dynamic in that group isn't the same. But, you know, I've got to reinforce. When I made John Smith captain at 24 of the national team, he had to grow as a captain, became one of the best captains South Africa's ever had. He's going to be the same, Ruan. He's going to learn, you know, a couple of games, or last game, you know, sort of questioned about not going for poles, you know, this time. Maybe they should have thrown to the back. He does the line-out calling, you know. You're thrown to the back, we score where they say he's a genius. So yeah, we're missing, of course we're missing. But, I mean, it's no excuse. They're missing, I think, 5 or 6 World Cup winners, you know. So I suppose that's the one thing, Brendan, that I think would have been nice is to beat... You know, to beat them at home with them, their main guys missing. But credit to them. They're obviously better than people give them credit for. You know, they're better than people think they. And they seem to have our number. You know, they seem to have our number in the URC. And sport works like that. You know, of course it works. It's not great, but the cycle will turn. The cycle will turn. I've got no doubt about that. You know.
Your thoughts on Adrian Lowe must be one of.
On who?
Adrian Lowe.
Oh yes, played well. Played really well tonight. Yeah, you know. Yeah. No, I was very happy with him. I mean, other than the fact he lost that ball from the kickoff in the very beginning of the, you know, from that, I think it was, I can't remember which one it was, but the one he lost when they ripped the ball out of his hands. You know, I thought he was outstanding. I mean, it was physical, and he, yeah, and I mean, I was happy with him. Difficult because he played with Nazam, who got injured, then he played with Carl, and then he played with us. So the combination's also a bit difficult for them. To get going, you know, but he was, you know, he was really good.
Jack, just on abrasive players, how did you rate Jacques Duplessis?
Yeah, I thought he was good. I mean, that's the first time he's played rugby. I mean, a full game in a long, long, long time, Ken. And I mean, he looked a bit tired at the end, to be fair to him. But geez, I mean, he again, you know, he stopped them all. He sacked it a few times. His carries were strong. And I know, as Brendan just said, you know, when Marcel comes back and we got him and we got, you know, one or two other guys that join us, then at least we'll have a pack. And not taking away, it'll be a bit older. Just a bit older, a little bit more streetwise than, you know, I mean, when you've played 4 or 5 years in France, like he has, you know, you're going to get better. It's going to get better and better as well.
Just one question on a previous subject about the street smart difference between the two teams. It looked like Pokobela's try was short.
Mm.
If you look at the body language of the Stormers players, only Van Heeren had a half-hearted fist bump. Mm. The rest of them stood back, and then he moved forward. So,
yeah, that too. But also, I mean, that's because that's why you have a TMO, you know. I mean, that's why there's a guy sitting there. I mean, the reality is he sees. Yeah, but you can't ask questions. Otherwise, you get told not to. You know, I mean, the point is not as simple as saying, "Can you do me a favor?" There's no referrals. It's not like. So the TMO's got to look, and if he's happy before the kick goes over or even after the kick goes over and he goes, hang on, it's not a try. I mean, if you look at their very first penalty they got, it looked like a knock-on, then the rest said play on, and then we played on, and then after all that, there was like a silence for about 20 seconds, and he said, okay, you knocked it on, you in front, penalty. Now, that was the TMO that said that. You know, so what I'm saying is the TMO's got the power to say whatever he sees, so... I mean, I can only answer this and say he must have thought it was a try because I can't believe the TMO wouldn't have seen what you saw, you know.
There's one significant difference this season in your second season in the URC from last season, and that's the inclusion of the Champions Cup for the,
yes.
The Bulls and Stormers and for the Sharks. Is that having an impact on your depth and injuries and making a change as to what you're doing with your lineups at this stage of the season? Because it's almost like you're playing rugby almost every week.
Yeah, not yet. I'm saying that not yet. I mean, we've been fortunate enough that it hasn't affected. We've still got, you know, relatively most of our players available for every weekend. I mean, obviously there's the exception like Huison, who's had an operation, and you know, but generally it hasn't affected it. I'm sure going into the back end of the competition, it's going to play a massive role for all the teams, not just for us. I mean, you've got to play Ulster away and then Toulouse the next weekend, guys. I mean, think about it. Ulster away and Toulouse and two consecutive weekends with the player base and the player budgets that we have in South Africa. You know, I've shared with you before, you know, Munster and Leinster have a player budget of about 185 million rand. Our player budget's probably 95 million rand now. I mean, you work it out yourself, you know. So it's one of those things, but we're going to have to get it right, you know. Thank God I've got, you know, shareholders that see it and understand it. I've got a CEO who understands it. And so this is a tough second year for us. But we're going to have to find a way in the next couple of years to get better, you know, better, how can I put it to you, better experienced players as your weaker players in your squad, you know.
Jake, jammer vir die verloor. Net 'n kortliks ter opsomming, Jou. Hoe som jy die wedstrijd op en waar dink jy, waar was jy tekortkoming gewees? Kan jy dalk moeilik van sê, wat Sbonkos se status, het hy enigstens homself beseer?
Wie? Wat het hy nou gesê? What did he say? Sorry.
I just want to know if it's boomed self-beseer in hy wedstrijd.
What did he say? So boo in Kosi?
Yes, sir.
Oh, nee, hy is reg, hy het net 'n stamp op die been gekry, so daar is niks beserings met hom nie, en Percival, ek het nou net vir almal hierso gesê, jy weet, ons het ons kansen gehad, tot op die einde, twee lijnstaande, 5 meter van die doellijn af, nie klaargemaak nie, ja, en ons het precies soos in die laaste game, miskien die 10, 15 minuten na rusttijd, het ons probeer, ons kon nie uit ons halfgebied uitkom nie, ons kwartgebied uitkom nie, ons baie druk op onsself gesit, jy weet, en weer eens, hy het 'n geel kaart gegee, so met 14 manne gespeel, so dit het maar moeilik vir ons gegaan om my game te wen met 14 manne en ons was achter op die telbord.
Check, is die wedstrijd genoeg rede vir jou as afdirekteur van rugby of vele spelers om slaaplose nagte te hê na die verloor?
Nee, ek sal dit reg kry, Percival. Ek sal dit reg kry. I mean, dis hoekom ek het hierdie werk gedoen vir jare. So ek is... Dat is nog lang tyd om te gaan, en soos ek sê, jy weet, dis nie lekker nie, en dis maar moeilik om na die game, as jy, jy weet, die possession gewen, jy die territory gewen, en dan nog steeds is jy is 13-12 agter rusttyd, en jy het amper alles reg gedoen in die eerste helft, so, nee, ons sal verbeter, ek het sonder twyfel, ek sal het reg kry, en die spelers, jy weet, Daar was nie een speler wat vanavond nie hard gespeel het nie, wat sy beste gegee het nie, en dat is al wat jy kan verwag as a coach.
At 12-3, do you think that the guy sort of...
No, I didn't. I didn't think they did anything wrong. I mean, the reality is, I said it, you know, the bottom line is the Stormers scored a try, and all of a sudden it was 13, it was 12-10. I mean, that's how it works, you know. So I don't think it was purposeful that they took their foot off the gas. I don't think that they, you know, that... Yeah, it was a try. I thought, as I said to you, we were told that you can't break the 5 meter line from a scrum. And the forward pass they were looking at was probably the wrong one. They should have been looking at the one that came infield, not the one that went outside.
And the yellow card, Jack, to David Keel, it seemed like a dash.
Well, that's the margins, Ashok. If he catches that, we score under the poles. So, you know, I mean, I don't think he knocked it down. Again, that's my view. I mean, it happens, you know, in some guys. But I think they're so strict on it now. It was almost like he was guilty before there was any, you know, before there's any decision made. But, you know, I'm not going to moan about the referee. I'm not going to give you a front headline news tomorrow. Jake White says referees and, you know, it is what it is. We had a chance, even with 14 men, even with a yellow card, even with maybe we should have scored there, maybe, you know, we still had two chances in the last 2 minutes of the game or the last 20 seconds of the game to finish it off, and we didn't. So we can't blame... We can't blame anybody for losing that line-out and not finishing off that more.
Just, Jake, those last opportunities at the end, do you think perhaps a 5-meter tap kick trick play would have been
As fact, exactly the same happened in the Scarlets game. You know, we tap it, we don't score, then they go, why didn't you take the line-out? You know, I thought we could have thrown to the back of the line-out. We had three locks on the field. And to be fair, it probably would have worked because the Stormers chased forward and won that ball. You know, they wouldn't have anyone at the back, so we probably would have won that line-out to the back of the line-out, and who knows. But that's exactly it, Ashfaq. That's the margins. I mean, you know, my captain will get it right. He'll get it right. You know, he's going through a tough time now with calls and, you know, people double guessing whether or not he's got the right calls. I've been through this with John Smith. I've been through this with young captains. He'll learn. He'll get better. You know, he's not happy. He's obviously dropped his, you know, how can I put it to you? He dropped his head. He's a little bit down on himself, and he knows how important his role is. But that's part of what we got to do. We got to help him through this time.
Yeah, Jake. Commiserations. You seem to struggle with the breakdown better. The likes of those Thomas Fitches, your Dion Priest seem to get.
Yeah, you hit it on the head, Caleb. You hit it on the head. We struggled with the breakdown interpretations.
Okay, so it was. Do you think you'd have adapted better in the second half because it was a turnover that finally also got the Stormers back possession when you guys were chasing that game?
Yeah, yeah. Look, we should have. As I said, we were under the poles there after about 10, 15 phases. Probably got it inaccurate there. You know, we should have kept the ball, kept building pressure. And we probably weren't, we weren't accurate enough to keep that ball. I think if we had kept it, you know, who knows? Maybe we would have been able to score. So, yeah, it's a... I'm not going to nail anybody. As I said, I've seen this movie before as well. So we lost fair and square. We had a chance at the end. A couple of things I think we could have adapted better. And we'll have to learn those things as we go deeper into this competition.
Yeah, Jake is at 90. I just wanted to know, look, you spoke about keeping the ball. There were a few times when you guys were on attack and you gave a kick over the middle or the top.
Yes.
Was that part of the plan? Or
yes, that was a play, and in fact, it nearly worked. You know, it nearly worked because the Stormers defend with no one in the midfield there. We just got the ball out too slowly. I think if the ball had come out the tempo that we wanted to come out, we would have basically had no one in the midfield there. I think, you know, the fact that it got stuck in there for whatever reason. You know, we never got quick enough ball there. It was one of the areas we thought we'd catch them in the midfield there because they close on the edge so quickly. It was just from a tactical point of view. But as I said, we didn't get the ball out as quickly as we could. If you go look at the clip, if we'd got that ball out 2 seconds earlier, there was no one there.
Just in hindsight, looking at a guy like Manny Lubbock, today you see his dropkick under pressure. Obviously, it's nice and cool and calm and collected.
Yeah.
Just his progression at the Stormers. Obviously, he was at the Bulls previously, and at that time, he wasn't at the level that he is now.
Yeah.
Just your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so Adnan, very good question. I mean, when I look at him, I think, geez, he's playing well, and, you know, he wins a game. It's almost like he loves playing against the Bulls. He's played well against us every time. It's almost like his way of showing me we should have kept him at the Bulls, but... I can tell you, if I mention names like Rudolf Strahle, Hannes Strydom, Gavin Johnson, Johnny Roo, the list just goes on and on and on. Those guys all left Northern Transvaal to go to the Lions under Kitch Christie, and they all became World Cup winners. And sometimes that's what happens. You know, some players leave a franchise, they got another franchise, they get a chance to play, they play well. You know, so maybe. Moni should thank me for releasing him because at least now he's playing well and he wouldn't have been playing for us because we had Mornay Steyn and we had Chris Smith and we had Johan Goosen. So sometimes you've got to make a call. Sometimes you get it right, sometimes you get it wrong. Sometimes the player needs a change of the environment. I've seen many, many players go from here to another place and not play well. I've seen guys come to us and play well. So, yeah, I mean... Not taking it away from him, he's playing really good rugby. And whatever they're doing with him at the Stormers is working. He seems to gel nicely with that back line. He seems to not gel nicely with either Warwick Gallant at 15 or Clayton Blomaches at 15. So that whole jigsaw puzzle, Adnan, is probably working for him, which is great for him.
Commiserations on the defeat. Jake, I just want to know, he's obviously lost 5 times to the Stormers now. Could you just tell us from your point of view, what do you think makes the Stormers side that good at the moment?
Yeah. I think momentum, Mabin, to be fair, momentum. I think anyone who's in sport knows that sometimes you're at the crest of a wave and things are working in your favour and you've got to enjoy it. You know, I think you look at a lot of teams, you know, a lot of sporting teams enjoy the times that things are working. They enjoy times that, as I said earlier, sometimes the ball bounces for them, or they, you know, the And again, not taking it away from them, because I don't want you to sound as though that, like, they, you know, sometimes it is sports like that. And they seem to be working nicely. It seems to be working for them. Difficult team to break down defensively. But, you know, Norman Laker, Darvey Snyman and Dobson have been with this team for a long, long time. They've been through the junior ranks, whatever. So, it for me, it just reaffirms everything I've always said about coaching, is when you're with a group of players for a long, long time, it becomes so much easier to get them to understand how you think as a coach. You know, Kitch Christie, for argument's sake, I used him just now. When he was with Transvaal for X amount of time, he went to the box. Box won the World Cup. When I was coaching the Springboks, I'd coached Gary Boerter, Guthro Steenkamp, Ashwin Willemse, all those players. You know, Clyde Rathbone, John de Villiers, Ricky January, Farid Dupria as a junior. So not only did I coach the box for 4 years, I probably coached that group of players for 6-7 years. And I think sometimes when you underestimate the value of what a coach can do when he's with a group of players for a long time.
Jake, just off the field, I think it's massive to see you putting faith in Sbu as he just returned to the boys. And what do you think that will do as a whole for our rugby community, that we can actually share some of our struggles and for the wider community as a whole?
Caleb, I'm a dad. I'm a dad of boys that are 31 and 27. He didn't need to be punished. I mean, I get people saying, why are you playing him? I mean, you don't get punished because you've had to go and sort yourself out, you know. So he's a Springbok. He's a World Cup winner. He wants to play rugby, he gets picked to play rugby. I mean, I'm not going to punish him now because he's been going through a difficult time. So, yeah, I compliment Edgar Rathbone and the way the Bulls have handled it. I compliment the way that Sabu came back. You know, he had to prove to the players that he really wants to play rugby again because of the fact that of what he's been going through. You know, and as I said, as a dad, I mean, I'm proud of the guy. Proud that he actually, you know, it must be difficult for him. He's come back. He hasn't touched a rugby ball in and he plays in front of 41,000 people. So, yeah, it's a great message for rugby, isn't it? I mean, it's a great message, and it's a great message for the Bulls too. I mean, as I said, what Edgar did and the way we've helped him and the way that the sort of response we got, I mean, that's a feel good story. I'd like him to have scored another try and won the game, and it would have been a great story, but. Yeah, I think we can be really proud of the way he's come through. We just got to make sure now we help him. It's not all good on Monday. We've got to make sure that we help him consistently.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.